By far the largest church denomination in the Union of South Africa is the Dutch Reformed Church, with a membership of almost 2 million white and non-white members. With us this morning is Dominee Adrian Burger, Secretary of the Federal Council of Dutch Reformed Churches and editor of Die Volkerkerk, the Transvaal Church magazine. Dominee Burger, you believe in apartheid as a way of life.
Yes, I do.
Why?
In South Africa.
Why is that, sir?
Because the race, which is in a lesser state of development, is by far in the majority here. And numerically, of course, they are much stronger. And because also I believe that it is according to God's will that the white race, which is in the majority in this country, should be preserved. And also everything we have done in the last 300 years and built up in the church and in the state should be preserved and not be swallowed up by an, I wouldn't say inferior race, because I don't believe it is an inferior race, but a lesser, a race which is in a lesser state of development, that's all.
Do you find any conflict between apartheid and Christianity?
No, certainly not. As a matter of fact, our Dutch Reformed churches are doing much more for the Christianization of the non-white people in this country than any other Protestant church in this country and anywhere in Africa. We as Christians believe in the development of the non-white people, and we certainly try to develop them as far as possible by building their churches, giving, subsidizing them in their church work, and we are also trying to give them leadership where they want it. And our experience is that these people prefer to be left in their own churches. As a matter of fact, there are 9 different non-white churches belonging to the Dutch Reformed Church amongst the non-white people. And they prefer that. There are instances when we come together on a higher level in conferences and sometimes also in their churches. We often come there as white people to visit them, and there are also instances where we even have communion with them.
Can you foresee any eventual end to apartheid in the Dutch Reformed Church?
The Dutch Reformed Church does not practice apartheid because we believe that integration is religiously wrong or ethically wrong. Certainly not. In theory, we have nothing against integration. It's only a matter of practical policy in this country. Now, for this moment, if conditions should change, this or any other practical policy could also be changed.
I see. Mr. Prinsloo, what is the basic philosophy underlying apartheid as a way of life?
We Europeans who've lived in this country for more than 300 years have come to a conclusion which is strange to some people in the Western world, namely that the peoples of Africa, and so the Bantu people of South Africa, have a beautiful civilization of their own which is worth preserving. There are many facets of this civilization, for instance, the social warmth of the Bantu peoples, which we Westerners can rightly envy them. Now, we also have a peculiar Western adaptation to Africa. Therefore, we can say that the Bantu peoples are a flower, and the Western peoples are a flower, each with a beauty of its own.
Mr. Prinsloo, as you are no doubt aware, most criticism of apartheid outside the Union is based largely on moral grounds. For example, the morality of separate residential areas in the cities of the Union, pass laws, lack of voting rights, and so on. How would you reply to this?
As far as residential areas are concerned, the practical situation is that until about 10 years ago, there were no residential areas for urban Bantu people. It is only in the last few years that such areas were set aside on a planned basis and developed at a terrific pace, as you can see all around you. This housing scheme, which now houses more than 30,000 urban Bantu who work in Pretoria, was a bare plain a mere 4 years ago. I think that is a complete answer to the so-called immorality of separate residential areas. In the political field, we are creating an outlet in that we are proclaiming Bantu authorities in all the major Bantu areas of the Union. We have already brought into life more than 300 such authorities where Bantu who have the inclination, the training, and the moral courage to start developing their own people can do so with all possible assistance from the government.
Is the government convinced that the African wants and accepts apartheid as a development policy?
For obvious reasons, many opponents of this policy tried to influence the Bantu people in the other direction. And like all new philosophies, like all new policies, we had to put our case to the Bantu people. And I can safely say today that the Bantu people are accepting the policy of self-development, which essentially is apartheid essentially is in an ever-increasing tempo. I feel confident that the Bantu leadership of Africa, rural and urban, will, by the turn of next year, show in a most marked way that they are satisfied that this policy leads to their salvation.
You have said repeatedly that the non-European is different from the European. Now, in your mind, is different synonymous with inferior?
I think it is a generally accepted fact today that the non-European is at a lower stage of development than the non-European, than the European. That does not mean to say that they are inherently inferior. Circumstances amongst which they have grown up and their whole cultural background and everything, their whole diet, which would lead to physical or physiological changes in their whole nervous system, would all lead to a general idea of inferiority amongst you when you compare the average non-European with the European. But I do not believe that the non-European as such is inherently inferior. He's merely at a much lower state of development.